So what are you doing on Sunday, other than watching the Rugby World Cup, which kicked off today, and rooting for South Africa, who's playing Scotland in Marseille in France? Let's look at our chances.
This is Eyewitness News.
Well, over the next 7 weeks, you can expect to see 20 teams competing in 48 matches. The Springboks are the reigning champions and begin their title defence this Sunday against the re-energised Scotland side, who are also ranked in the top five. And following their victory over the All Blacks 2 weeks ago, and with a full-strength side at their disposal, South Africa are the favourites to edge the Scots, who haven't beaten SA since 2010. Before that, though, hosts France play New Zealand in the tournament opener on Friday evening at 9:15. Mawande Mateza, Eyewitness News Sport.
At the moment, we have one person who claimed that this is his property. So we found him on site. So he's one of the 20 people that has been arrested. So they will be processed now at the police station.
Okay. I know that you don't want to jeopardize the investigation, but saying things like high-profile people that are involved, can you elaborate on that?
Okay. It's businessmen, police from SAPS, a kennel who is involved. He has signed the attendance register of the minutes that discussed the taking over of this place.
There's the confirmation of what we probably all already knew. High-profile characters, including police, behind Johannesburg's property hijackings. Is this why nothing is done about these dangerous structures? Until it's too late and people die. Just look at this building in downtown Joburg. The squalor people live in, and they pay rent for it too.
These are the lifts in Varincourt, just filled with dirt and waste. Stagnant pools of water all over and the stench of urine all over the place. This is one of the rooms or how people are living in here. This is a typical room. Mattresses. Don't know if you can see it, but flies are just swarming all over this room. So this is basically the courtyard of Varincourt. It's a 8-story building, and the city are embarking on an inspection of it. Many of the residents in this building are believed to have been or believed to be illegally occupying. Now, going through this corridor here, there's an interesting little shaft here that leads directly out and access to one of the roads in the area. The shaft is used mainly, from what some of the residents have told us, by criminals, Hunger Boys, Nyaupi Boys, to escape quickly should there be a raid or anything conducted in this building.
Property attorney Greg Vermaak says the living conditions in some of these buildings are inhumane.
I genuinely believe that there are places, there are buildings that are more dangerous to live in than living on the street. Now, it's not appropriate. No one should live on the street in a country. But if the people in 80 Albert Street would have been better off sleeping on the pavement than in that building.
EWN also witnessed a raid on a building just as it was being hijacked.
We're currently on scene in Industrial West in Johannesburg, where we're at a vacant property owned by the city, right? And the city officials, as well as JMPD, you see a number of members here and officials here, including the executive mayor and the city manager, are claiming that this building has been invaded. And people were constructing on this building. Now, this building or this property itself is very important because the city had highlighted or set aside this property for to house or temporarily house the people that were affected by the Marshalltown building fire. But what business owners are telling us is that they got into an agreement with the local station commander, all right? And the station commander agreed that they could come in and basically fence off and put up brick walls to not allow people to come and invade this property.
One step closer to catching the killers of rapper Keenan, aka Forbes. Police say they'll soon arrest those behind the murder. They have the gun, the getaway car, and spotters have been identified. They've confirmed the recovery of the gun used to kill the musician. It was recovered in May in Umlazi, south of Durban. And that's 4 months after we broke the story. AKA was gunned down in a brazen hit outside Wish Restaurant on Durban's popular Florida Road. He was shot and killed with his celebrity friend Tebelo Tibs Motswane.
We've identified at least a couple of vehicles that were used. Some of the vehicles we use as getaway. Some of the vehicles that we use as porters. Some of the vehicles that might have been used by people after the fact that we suspect that they are a suspect in this regard. We've identified at least one firearm that has been used and positively identified to have shot and killed Mr. Forbes on that eve.
At the time, a man in his 20s was detained for the illegal possession of a firearm and ammunition. He's believed to have provided police with information pertaining to whom he purchased the firearm from. Police confirmed that the gun has gone for ballistic testing in KZN's forensic lab as well as Pretoria to verify the ballistic results. Gang rape, sodomy for food, and extreme violence. We go inside one of South Africa's most dangerous prisons. Some of the more than 3,000 high-risk inmates at an American-run private prison in Limpopo tell us that to get decent food, they have to buy it from prison officials. A piece of steak, chicken or lamb chops, costing between 40 and 45 rand. If not, they have to eat pup, polony, and hard-boiled eggs. And this is despite the Kutama Sintumule Correctional Center having a budget of more than 400 rand to feed and clothe each inmate per day. A former prison warden says some inmates are forced to commit sexual acts to make money in prison to buy food.
Offenders find themselves trapped in a state of being prostitutes in order to make ends meet, in order to buy toiletries and other necessities.
After submitting a memorandum to management about conditions, inmates rioted at the prison last month and burned down three centres at the facility. One of them, who's since been transferred to another facility following the fire, says Kutama is like living in hell.
And I won't go back to Kutama. I'd rather die. That thing of those men in prison, you know, those things fighting each other, that stampede amongst the inmates. That thing makes me, man, I've lost my mind a little bit because I've been there for quite some time. I don't want to lie.
Justice Minister Ronald Lamola says they are investigating allegations contained in the memorandum. Former Minister Mosabenzi Zwane faces more punishment after missing a National Assembly sitting where he was to be reprimanded for his Gupta-related ethics transgressions. In March, Parliament's Joint Committee on Ethics and Members' Interests found Zwane guilty of failing to declare Gupta-sponsored travel and benefits. Zwane was supposed to apologise and be reprimanded, but he failed to pitch. The Ethics Committee had recommended that he be fined the amount of 5 days' salary.
Knowing very well that we're supposed to be here in this house today for the reprimand, I cannot account on his whereabouts when he's not here in the house. I suggest that the Speaker find accordingly and act accordingly.
The National Health Department says it's reviewing its proposed dress code policy for nurses following backlash from Muslim nurses. The changes to the controversial policy were first communicated to provincial heads of departments about 2 months ago. One of those changes is the ban of headscarves for nurses while on duty. Health Department spokesperson Foster Mohale says a number of stakeholders have expressed their reservations about the policy and all inputs will be considered.
We are trying to be accommodative as possible, taking into consideration the religious and the other factors that have been raised by a number of stakeholders.
Nursing Director at the Islamic Medical Association of South Africa, Hani Ali, says they're concerned that this may discourage Muslim women from being nurses.
We fully recognize that regulations and standards are put in place so that medical practitioners can perform at their highest standards. But where is there empirical evidence and hygiene concern where the staff can cause cross-infection?
This came about because of hygiene concerns relating to the scarf. That's it from me, Jane Dutton. Remember to like and subscribe.
Eyewitness News. In touch, in tune, and independent. For the latest, log on to ewn.co.za or ewn.mobi.